still feel guilty that I still feel guilty that all the work you do for me. I won't be doing work. Well, but it's time. Y'all got about 15 minutes. Right.
That's all the people got. Just a little bit, maybe.
Thank you.
up and run again. Let run again while he's talking. He's got a picture of just him.
Yeah, I'll start after this.
Yeah. is funny. I'm dangerous.
We've got about 2007. Since a lot of y'all have never been to the museum, I want to talk to you a little bit about being more involved with the museum. There are letters as you go out the door here. You'll see them laying on that table. If you don't mind picking up one and just reading, you know, what it has to say. If you're interested in getting our email blast, there's several ways you can do that. You can either leave me your email address. If you're on Facebook, you can sign up there to get our email blast. We also have a Facebook group and a page where you can find out information about what's going on at the museum. If you want on our direct mail list, you can leave me your address, and I'll be glad to do that too. But we encourage all of you to be involved with the museum. September, we have our biggest fundraiser, and we'd like to invite y'all to come back. We're already starting to get donations for that. So if you have items that you'd like to donate, gift certificates, anything like that, if you have a business. I know Timmie always donates pictures and books and things, and those always go very well. So if you have a business or you have items that you'd like to donate or gift certificates, get with us on that too. Over spring back break, we had lots of visitors coming to the museum. A lot of people from out of town, Wisconsin, Minnesota. Lots of people were bringing in their kids that were out of school. A lot of grandparents had kids. And we had a lot of first-time visitors, so I was real pleased. I know one day we probably had 30 people come through. It was just a busy, busy day that day. I know a lot of y'all are familiar with John A. Gann. You know that he's been sick. Like to ask you to keep him on your prayer list. I have heard from him, which is a good sign. And he was a little, you know, back to his old self. So I think he's still in rehab, though, and don't know how long he'll be there. So just kind of remember John, because there's a lot of stuff that I could not do without John's help. He's helping me right now work on 3 books about cemeteries. And, you know, anytime I have a question, I can ask him, and he just knows the answer, you know, right off the top of his head. So he's a very valuable asset to the parish and our parish history. Next month, Claire Turner, Fusel, will be telling her story about her family, and I know that's going to be great. And Claire's here tonight. Where's she? Hiding in the back. No, it slips or falls before next month. And our DVDs will be available about this talk here in the next couple of weeks. Of course, Phil there is recording it. Since the weather is so bad, we probably will redo this talk again in October because we did not have a planned speaker so far for October. And I hate, as much work as Timmy's done on this program, I want him to have a packed house, not just the kitchens.
It would be a packed.
Yeah, so all y'all have to come back and then bring the rest of the McEachern's and we'll be good. And I know a lot of, even the McEachern's didn't want to get out in the weather, so you know it's bad. So, we'll be probably redoing this one again in October, so this will be Timmy's trial run. At the end of this program, he has brought some of his books, and he'll be glad to sign one of those for you, and you can purchase those. They're great books, make great gifts, and make a great addition to anybody's personal library. I'm not going to do a whole lot of introduction because I think he's got something planned for my kitchen introduction. Timmy, you want to step up? Or you want to roll with that?
Mm-hmm.
some technical difficulties. This has worked perfect. Always.
Good time for Jesus to turn this into some wine. Calm the nerves just a little bit. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We did get a half a packed house in the midst of a flood in Minden, Louisiana, which is about typical. I was expecting a breathing room only in this place today from the way it all started out, but lo and behold, the clouds opened up and just poured down some rain. God, I thought we needed just a little bit more of that 25 inches we got last week. That's all right. But I just wanted to start off by saying thank you to each and every one of you to come out and got wet and in this nasty weather just to be a part of this little presentation that we put together, worked real hard on, and I think you're going to enjoy it. At least some of you are going to enjoy it. If you don't, I'm going to tell some fishing stories and we're going to run you out here on here. I have everything listed. I've got several topics on the agenda tonight we're going to talk about. I've got them listed as three little elves. And that's not to be confused with the three little pigs in Aesop's fable. So this is three little elves. And they represent three very important things in my life. My family, my faith, and my fishing. For those that don't know me, these few over here, I guess, my name is Timmie McEachern. McEachern, however you want to say it. It's been pronounced probably 50 different ways, and I'm going to show it to you so you believe me when I get out of here tonight. I'm the fourth child and second son of Wesley Carson and Virginia Holloway McEachern. I was born right here in Minden, Louisiana, about three rock throws behind this building at the Minden Sanitarium. I always tell people I was born in Sanitarium Dairy. I graduated from Minden High School, and I've been employed at Nita's Barbecue for over three quarters of my life, 47 years this past January, if you can believe that, ever since I was 10 years old. Couldn't hardly see over the little quarter window there. I'm a lover of nature, and anything that's got to do with nature, I'm all for it, with whitetail deer hunting and largemouth bass fishing at the top of my list. I'm an aspiring photographer, and you can bet anywhere that I go, I've got my camera in my truck and on hand ready to capture that perfect photograph, just trying to get the ultimate, whatever catches my eye. I'm a combination songwriter, composer, poet, with several poems in print through the International Library of Poetry Books, with the Fallen Rain and Stars in My Heart, to name a couple. And just this past year, I went out on my first solo project, a book of poems entitled Rhymes Without Reason, a collection of poems inspired by God, nature, and the South. Three of my favorite things, once again. And later on in this presentation, I'm going to share one of my favorite songs, sang by my little baby sister over here who's claimed it as her own, no doubt. And also I'm going to close this out with a poem that's special to me. Now that's enough about me. Let me introduce to you my bodyguard for tonight. In case things get real bad, I've got some protection. Ladies and gentlemen, hailing all the way across the world from a little peninsula on the westernmost part of Scotland, from a little piece of land called Kintyre, the land of origination of my McEachern family, to our great hometown of Minden, Louisiana, meet Sir Ethan Spillers. Ethan is my cousin, and he is the grandson of my father's sister, who is Jamie Sue McEachern Kenyon. Wave your hand so they know you're proud of this. He has so graciously offered to represent his McEachern family by wearing the famed tartan plaid of our Scottish ancestors, and to display the great and mighty broadsword that our McEachern family was so famous for in olden times. He has also offered to do the narration on the family history DVD, which we'll be showing you in just a few minutes. I'm talking to you about this kilt here. The Scottish kilt was the traditional dress of men and boys in the Scottish Highlands of the 16th century. And there were several different types that were worn. Some were full-length garments whose upper half could be worn as a cloak, or draped across the shoulder or rolled up over the head. The most common is like Sir Ethan has on, just the one that covers the body from the waist down to the center of his knees. The typical kilt was made of wool, and they all have a distinct weave pattern. One of the most distinct features of the Scottish kilt is the tartan pattern, or the set that it exhibits. While the kilt has no pockets, as you notice, no pockets attached to it, the sporran, which is this, is the Gaelic name for purse, is used as a wallet, or for the same uses as pockets are in modern day apparel. Another accessory to the Scottish ensemble is the cap, and the two that are most used are the Balmoral and the Glengarry bonnet. And last but not least, Ethan has brought for us all to see tonight something that our McEachern ancestors of ancient times were so recognized for and noted for back in the day, the famous broadsword. Usually weighed upwards of 5 pounds and being about 36 inches in length, not only was it a mighty killing weapon, but also, because of its size, was very intimidating. Very intimidating, and somebody draw that back. Yeah. Get your attention real quick, huh?
Can you raise it up?
Some of you know, a lot of countries have what they call a family coat of arms. And this is the McEachern coat of arms right here, and we'll try to explain what a little bit of these symbols represent. You see at the very top of this little banner right here, it says per mare, per terrace. That means by sea and by land. Each element in the coat of arms has a specific meaning that is regulated by a code of rules. You have the family crest, which is this right here. And also the basic component of the coat of arms is the shield or escutcheon. That's this ship right in here on this. And color is another important component of the coat of arms. Gold means generosity and high-mindedness. Silver or white means peace and sincerity. Red means strength and magnanimity. Blue means truth and loyalty. Green means hope and joy. And this is full of all of that. In the top left, hand of the corner here, this is a blue and white shield, and that is represents the country of Scotland, and it also means protection. On the top right, just barely can't see it in here, you probably have to look at it up close, but that's a picture of a lion up there, and that represents the lion with a high place of undying courage, and hence that of a valiant warrior. The two lions on the opposing sides of the page right here are named lion sergeants or supporters, and again are symbols of courage. The thistle is this item right here in the corner. It is an ancient heraldic symbol that represents pain and suffering. It says if a helmet is in the sand, which is the helmet right here, it represents wisdom and security, strength, protection, and invulnerability. Is also called the hymn.
Is there a fishing lure in that coat of arms?
It's got a great story. Just hang on. I will get to that in just a bit. I first started researching my family's history back in 1991 when I purchased my first computer. It was an old used computer. My brother-in-law said, man, we got my company's fixing to redo all the computers, put brand new ones in there. And he said, they're selling all the old ones for $100. You want one? I said, I have no use for a computer. I wouldn't know how to turn it on. He said, man, you need to get on up with the times and learn how to operate one. It's a very useful tool. So. He talked me into it. I whooped out $100 and hadn't looked back since. I went country boy, learned how to turn it on, and next thing I know, I started doing research. And found a family tree maker. My wife bought me one for Christmas that year, and I started looking up my family tree. And I'm looking to see how many monkeys gonna fall out of it. I started finding information out just left and right, and I would get so excited. And I remember going to my dad and saying, this is what I found out, Dad. I said, how come you never told me that, that your grandpa Silas, his middle name was Turner? He said, well, I didn't know that. He said, that must be why Mom and Daddy named Jerry Turner. I said, yes, it must have been the very reason. I said, Daddy, did you know that Governor George Wallace's grandmother was a McEachern? No, I didn't know that. And I just went on and on and on and on. I was telling him one thing, and he was only one I could talk to that seemed like he was halfway interested. I tell Glenn or Jenny or somebody like that, I said, hey, this is what I found out. He said, you're passing your biscuits over there, please. I didn't care less. Okay. He showed up on the night. That's all good. One day I was messing with Daddy. Every time I'd come in, I'd tell him, you know, something new that I had dug up and found. I said, Daddy, I said, the McEachern name dates back. It's one of the, if not the oldest name in Western Scotland. And I said, you know what else I found out? I said, you know Mary, Jesus' mom? She was a McEachern. That look on his face. He'd been gone 17 years, and I can still see that face. He looked at me like, you know, what? That's amazing. Anyway, let's carry on. In my research, one of the first things that I always did when I met new cousins abroad that I had never met, first thing that always come out of my mind was, how do y'all pronounce his last name? So we got a few different pronunciations in our own line right here, and a lot of times it's common, sometimes it's aggravated. And I've seen it written somewhere that there are nearly 50 different pronunciations and our spellings of our surname. I thought it would be kind of neat a couple of weeks ago if I could get some of our family members just to video themselves, saying, introducing themselves for the people here tonight. Then I got thinking, I said, let's take it a little further. I said, I'm going to get on the internet and talk to some of these in Scotland and Australia and Canada. And I said, let's see if I can talk to some of them into making some videos for me as well. Well, I like to start a war on the internet with some of them, because once I had to make one for myself doing it, and they all went crazy over me. They thought, man, I ain't never heard anybody pronounce it like that. Some of them got mad about me. And matter of fact, after it was all over with, after about 3 weeks of it, one of them come back on there and said, what, you got anything else you want to get started on here? I said, no, y'all done well to follow up on that. I got a lot of them to respond to me and in the written word, and I'm going to share a few of them. And just from all over, some of them said McEachern, 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 and the list just goes on and on and on. It's nothing like hearing it for yourself.
How do you pronounce it?
How do I pronounce it?
Very careful.
Evidently, I pronounce it McEachern and McEachern, just like most of our family members do. It's according to the moment and how I'm caught. If I'm caught on guard, I've got time to think about it, I'll say McEachern like my English teachers told me in school, grammar school. She said, it's not McEachern, it ain't a K in that name, it's McEachern. And that's those syllables and vowels. And so now I'm at a confused state, but after I was thinking it was McEachern for 57 years, I find out after talking to these on the internet that I wasn't even close to it. So, y'all tell me what my name is after this is all over. Kind of end out. But if you'll run that number 3 for me, I can kick off. And I'm sorry for the delay on it. I don't know what happened to the. A little technical difficulty. We went through it about 5 times and it was working perfect, naturally, you know, and then that little booger got in there somewhere.
I did do it right the other day, remember?
Yeah, you were doing fine. No problem.
Blame it on the weather.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, I mean,
Louisiana, we appreciate the fact that we're from southern Canada here, the deep south of southern Ontario. And here we say McEachern. So I do like the McEachern, that's great, I like eating, but here we say McEachern.
Hello, my name is Terry McEachern, live in Thompson Tack, New Brunswick, sixth generation Canadian. We say McEachern as McEachern here in Thompson Tack, New Brunswick.
Hello, my family and I pronounce Ibis
makes our last name pretty similar. My dad's from New Brunswick, and he pronounces it as McEachern. And I'm from Ontario, and I pronounce it as McEachern, because the E-R-N at the end, I just sort of would pronounce it the way it was spelled, I suppose. Anyways, I would actually like to learn the proper way. If it was the Gaelic way, I'd like to learn that way. But anyways, that's how I've always pronounced it my whole life, and my dad, I've always heard him say McEachern, and it would always make me laugh every time I heard it.
With regards to the debate on how to pronounce their second name, I'm Colin Neal, born on the west coast of Scotland in 1969, and son of Kenneth McEachern, who was the son of Donald McEachern. I'm also the nephew of Peggy and Arthur McEachern. I pronounce our name McEachern.
I have heard it said as McEachern, 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 which actually I get McEachern crazy often. I have a Scottish friend from Glasgow once say, how do you pronounce my last name, man? And he said it was McEachern, like McEachern, but with more draw. You gotta do the whole thing to the Scottish thing. McEachern. Those are the ways I've heard it said, but loving the hearing the different pronunciations, that's great.
McEachern. McEachern. McEachern.
I'm white. American Nova Juanita McEachern. She's the daughter of Wesley Carson McEachern and Virginia Holloway. We were married April the 7th, 1971. We have two daughters, Amanda and Heather.
Hi, I'm Nola Juanita McEachern White, and I'm the daughter of Wesley Carson and Virginia Holloway McEachern. We live in Springfield, Missouri. I have two daughters, Amanda and Heather, and we love the McEachern family.
Oh, McEachern, whichever way they want to say it.
How do you say it when you say, my name is Gerald?
McEachern.
All right.
I'm Gerald Leslie McEachern Jr. from Sibley, Louisiana, and I'm proud to be McEachern.
McEachern. McEachern.
Timmie McEachern.
Timmie McEachern. My name is Jenny Elaine McEachern Sims. I am the daughter of Wesley and Virginia McEachern. I am taking students at Central Elementary, and I am enjoying this year.
My name is Glenn Carson McEachern, the son of Wesley Carson McEachern. I'm the oldest son, and Grandma told me one time that all the McEachern were too lazy to pronounce their name right, but it's pronounced McEachern. I'm carrying out that tradition.
M-C-E-A-C-H-E-R-N, and McEachern, and my husband, of course, is sitting at my side, Glenn McEachern, and the pronunciation is McEachern. Thank you.
Can you tell me what your name is, sir?
John McEachern.
Thank you very much. I didn't hear you yet, did
you? No.
Tell me what your name is.
My name is Dennis McEachern.
What?
My name is Steve McEachern, and I'm from Minden, Louisiana. I'm out here on the job mowing grass.
I am Ellis McEachern from Minden, Louisiana. I live at 804 Clannish, in Minden.
Hey folks, I'm Jay McEachern from Minden, Louisiana.
Hi y'all, my name is Weston McEachern. I'm from Minden, Louisiana.
Hey guys, I'm Caitlin McEachern.
And I'm Bob McEachern.
And we're from Palm, Louisiana.
My name is Amy McEachern.
next DVD that I prepared for you this evening comes from the information that I've been fortunate enough to discover throughout the years of my research, and that has been passed down from one generation of our family to another. In Bible records, court documents, personal letters, and by word of mouth of our McEachern descendants. It tells about our immigrant ancestors' arrival to America 260 years ago, where they settled, where they lived and died, and the path of their descendants as they moved from one area of the country to another until they ended up in this little small community called Minden, Louisiana. And this is where my partner's gonna kick in. He's gonna do the narration on this video for us, which we're starting on the fourth example of history, whichever one it is.
Once upon a time, far, far away, on a little peninsula on the westernmost part of Scotland named Kintyre, lived a large group of people called McEacherns. This is where my story begins. According to George T. Black, in his writings, The Surnames of Scotland, The Origin, Meaning, and History, our surname was derived from the Gaelic, Mac Each Thy Erna. Which means sons of the horse lord. This name is one of, if not the oldest name, to be found in Western Scotland, dating back to 842 AD. 18 generations prior to 1436, through the pedigree of Seol Eachern. The McEacherns of old were trainers and breeders of the king's horses in Western Scotland. They were also hereditary armorers to the Lord of the Isles. As swordsmiths, they forged perhaps the finest broadswords in all the Highlands. Not very many years ago, an Isle of Crawford unearthed the McEachern broadsword. It was on the very site of where the conflict and battle of Bruinhart Strand took place. The broadsword is now on display in a museum in Edinburgh, Scotland. Approximately 1.5 million Scots have immigrated to America. They've been settling here since the earliest colonial days. Scores of books preserved in our country's rich history speaks of this great movement of people who came to this country from Ireland and Scotland. There were five great waves of immigrants from the Scotch-Irish, beginning in 1717 through 1718, until the final wave from 1771 to 1775, lasting 58 years in all. This would come to be known as the Great Migration. Many factors come into play. As for the reasons why so many a number of people would leave their homeland for a strange new world. poverty, wretchedness, misery, and want became almost universal among them all. Letters from the immigrants themselves spoke of rack rent as a determining cause. But this was only one of the unhappy circumstances of the common people that resulted in so great an exodus. Shortly after the end of the fourth exodus, in the year 1756, 21-year-old Robert McEachern boarded ship for the long journey across the Atlantic Ocean. All the way from his homeland on the peninsula of Kintyre, Scotland. Where a large majority of Scots landed was at Wilmington, North Carolina. And from there, they journeyed inland up the Cape Fear River, settling around Fayetteville, North Carolina, and the surrounding counties. And there in Robeson County, North Carolina, Robert McEachern settled and acquired a large amount of property close to the Lumber River. In 1765, Robert McEachern married Jeanette Henderson, a girl of Scottish parentage who had also been born in Kintyre, Scotland in 1743. Robert and Jeanette McEachern raised a large family with three identified sons and five identified daughters. John, James Henry, Hector, Flora, Christian, Isabel, Effie, and Jeanette were their names. Nestled under a canopy of shady oaks, not far from the Lumber River, on land that Robert McEachern acquired in his lifetime, is a small, enclosed area of iron fencing surrounding the graves of Robert and Jeanette Henderson McEachern and about a dozen other family members' graves. John, the oldest child of Robert and Jeanette, was born in circa 1770 in North Carolina and married a Mary, last name unknown, before 1800, because that's when the first child was born, a son, Daniel McEachern, born December 9, 1800. Three more children were born in North Carolina to John and Mary McEachern, beginning with Peter, Mary Ann, and Hector. John and Mary McEachern, along with their first four children, left North Carolina for Alabama, then moved again, settling in Claiborne County, Mississippi. Where John Jr., Neil, and James W. McEachern were born. From Claiborne County, they moved once again to Holmes County, Mississippi, near Pickens, where John and Mary lived out the remainder of their lives. John and Mary are presumed buried in the Harttown Cemetery, there near Pickens, which was inside of their son Peter's home and may have been on his property, and also the place where Peter, his wife Emma Lucinda, and his brother John A. McEachern is buried. John and Mary McEachern were parents of seven children, beginning with Daniel, Mary Ann, Peter, Hector, John Jr., Neil, and James W. James W. McEachern, the youngest child of John and Mary, married Margaret Steen on October 13, 1842, in Madison, Mississippi. The early married life of James and Margaret was spent in Holmes County, Mississippi, between 1854 through 1857. They moved to Claiborne Parish, Louisiana, living successfully in the old Shambaloo, Whitehall, and Hainesville communities. This was done in covered wagons, and the story from the old folks that has been passed down to later generations was that it was ox-driven as well. Thomas H. McEachern was the oldest son of James and Margaret Steen McEachern. He enlisted in the Confederate Army on August 13, 1861 at Camp Moore, Louisiana. He served as a cook and private musician in Company L, Louisiana 12th Infantry. He was discharged on April 25, 1865 in Greensboro, North Carolina. Thomas H. McEachern's younger brother, John W. McEachern, was discharged the next day on April 26, 1865. Thomas H. and John W. McEachern walked all the way home together to Shambaloo, Louisiana, following their discharge. 7 months later, on November 12, 1865, Thomas H. McEachern married Theodosia Ann Ward. Thomas and Theodosia had 10 children, and their names were Silas Turner, Maggie, Floyd Boy, Elijah, also known as Tobe, Joseph Thomas, Leonidas Love, Elizabeth, or Lizzie, Mary, Lillian, and Roy. Thomas and Theodosia lived their entire married life in the vicinity of Old Shambaloo, where Thomas served as Justice of the Peace, and where he performed numerous weddings for his area's neighbors, friends, and family. Thomas and Theodosia are buried in the Old Shambaloo Cemetery in Shambaloo, Louisiana, the final resting place of nearly 100 of our McEachern family members, spanning a time of nearly 160 years. Silas Turner McEachern was born February 4, 1867. He married Mary Iola Caswell when he was 22 years old on August 26, 1889, on Iola's 20th birthday. Silas Iola had six children: Arthur Cleveland, Ruthie, Albert Sidney, John Henry, Newbin, and my great-grandfather, Wesley. From those six children came a forever-growing number of McEachern's that are still living in this wonderful place that I call home. And the story never ends.
Research through the years, I've tried to recognize the similarities that one generation may have passed down to this generation before us, and such as our physical attributes, who we look like, what characteristics are unbelievably similar to those from the generation that came before us. Also, the traditions of our ancestors. What traditions did the McEachern family of old pass down to our generation that is evident today?
All right.
One right off the top of my head is that we are still clannish. The McEacherns of old were found in large groups all bunched up together in one area. They found that there was strength in numbers and incorporated this foundation into their lifestyles for helping one another and also for protection from anyone who tried to bring harm their way. And as I look back through the records that were available, the same is undeniable as they crossed over the ocean. Large groups were found in North Carolina, large groups were found in Mississippi, and once again, large groups were found in this town called Minden, Louisiana. I remember as a child, people saying, man, y'all live in McEachernville out there on North Sheet Road, because that's all it is out there. And that was pretty much the matter of fact. Just about all of Grandma Wesley and Oma's children, I think, except maybe one or two, lived out there on that Gillard and Cane Lake Road. Another thing that I saw that was similar in our McEachern family was that they were all, our family come from a family of believers. My grandmother Alma was a dedicated member of the Church of Christ in Minden for many years, for as long as I had been around. Silas Turner McEachern taught Sunday school at the old Shongaloo Methodist Church for several years. His brother Joe Thomas pastored the First Baptist Church in Spring Hill for many years. His son Albert City was a Baptist preacher. God blessed him with 91 years of life. James W. McEachern's record of birth and baptism was recorded in the old session book of Union Presbyterian Church in the Scotch settlement named Union Church in Claiborne County, Mississippi. So we know that his parents, John and Mary, were of the Presbyterian persuasion. And last but not least, our immigrant ancestors, Robert and Jeanette McEachern, were old school Presbyterians as well, as most Scots were during that time that they came and settled in North Carolina. What a great legacy and heritage that our McEachern family has passed down to our generation. God has blessed our McEachern family down through the years, and I believe that it's all because of their faith and trust in Him that this family is still going strong today. Many years ago, I wrote a song entitled Blessed River of Faith. I said my baby sister Jenny has claimed it as her own, and very well she should, because she sang it so many times in our local congregation, in a congregation of over 5,000 people, and done an awesome job with it. And I have to say, this is my favorite out of all this, that I've written, and I want to share that song with you this evening. And as I was going through the different recordings that I had that she's done through the years, I was trying to pick out the best one, because I want to really impress y'all with this. One song's just going to give you one of them. And I came across one where she was speaking to the congregation right before she began to sing. She said something that struck a nerve in my spirit, and I want to share this thought with you here tonight. She said, I can't tell you how many times that I've had to depend on my faith in God to get through a day. I don't know what people do that does not know God and that does not have Him to help him through the trials and tribulations that come to each one of us at one point or another in our lives. But every time that I've called upon God, He has always been there for me. As you listen to this song, I pray that you're blessed by it and that your faith in this God that we serve be increased forevermore.
And it flows through all our land. Canyons, tears.
for the favorite part of the program. We're going to talk a little bit about worms and fishing. I can do this without being nervous. This is the good part here. Back in 1991, the hot bait on the market was this little watermelon seed lizard dipped in crawfish orange dye. Dipped a little tail in crawfish dye. People were catching big old sow-bellied bass just left and right on this bait, fishing just like this, Carolina style. Had a little weight on the top of it. You throw it up under the trees and let it sink to the bottom. Fish picked it up, cut off it. You set the hook and bite him in the boat. For this particular day, I was Mr. C. Valentine, and gave me permission to fish some gravel pits up north of Dixie Inn. And I'd been up there just really wearing them things out, and this old boy told me, he said, you need to be throwing this lizard if you want to catch you a good one. So that morning, next Monday morning, I got up there and had this lizard tied onto bait, and I went to fishing down the first pit, got about 100 yards down that pit, hadn't caught a fish, and come to a little old tree that was hanging out over the water, and I flipped that, just made the perfect presentation, and flipped it right up under that bush like I knew what I was doing. It went down, and the time I got my slack out of my line, it had done taken off to the deep water. I said, oh, I've got something on it. I set the hook, and I knew as soon as I laid into it, I had a good fish on the end of that bait. Well, lo and behold, before I could get him to the boat, he decided he was going to break his line. I wouldn't have. Kind of hurt my feelings there. Anyway, I said, I'll be back after you next Monday. So sure enough, next Monday morning rolled around. First thing I thought of, that fish down there, it still got my name on it. I'm going to get it. I get up there and I'm fishing. Boy, I throw all around that particular bush where I let him get away from me. He wasn't coming out. He wasn't going to talk to me today. I fished that whole pit. Couldn't make nothing happen. I went on into the next pit and I decided I would change baits and I went to throw another bait. Caught a few little dinks, moved over to the third pit. Good, getting on back, pretty good piece in the back here, and I'm throwing this other bait. About that time, this big old bass comes up and just inhales that bait. Comes to be the biggest bass that I caught all day. Man, I was tickled with it. Nice bass. Well, lo and behold, I get home and go to feed land. I said, man, I'm going to have a good supper tonight with all this good mess of bass. And I saved that biggest one for last. I said, yeah, I'm going to enjoy filleting this thing. And when I laid that first fillet open, lo and behold, what was in the belly of that fish? I found a crawfish tail lizard with a red hook on it. I said, I was fishing this first pit where I hung him last week, and here he is, and I moved out. He knew I was coming. He got scared. People say that they'll do that. Fish fear me. You ask my brother Glenn. I put in those couple of good ones last week. He was there to witness.
How big was it again?
It was
it's bigger every time
he does. It gets bigger and better. It's going to be better in October if I get to come back. This second story, it's got a picture to go with it. This happens to be about 7 years ago. My brother-in-law, Collie Thomason, called me and said, I'm headed up to Canaan. He said, there's a front coming in. He said, them fish ought to be wearing them out today. He said, you want to go with me? I said, pick me up. I just got home from work. And I said, I'll be ready for waiting on you. He pulled in the driveway, and we hauled tail up to Upper Canyon Lake, right up there above the house. We hadn't got the boat in the water good. I'm back here trying to make room in his boat for all my junk that I brought with me. And lo and behold, he throws out there and hangs into a big old 6-pound bass right off the bat, first cast. He said, get a net, I got a good one. I'm looking in his boat. I said, you don't even have a net in this boat. Well, he's fighting that thing in. He gets it up to the boat. I said, ain't no way you get that big fish in there as big as that thing. He didn't break his line just trying to pull it over. He yanked it and it just flopped right over in his boat. I said, I couldn't have done that for nothing. About 15 minutes later, we look up here. Man, it's just like the world went dark. The clouds were real spooky and just mysterious looking, and all of a sudden we heard geese just making all kind of rattles. Where's all them geese at? And we looked over back toward the airport, and here come a whole flock of geese. And they go across the middle of the lake, and then they turn and head straight toward the boat, like they're coming right at us. Well, I'm grabbing for my camera, trying to get it out of the camera bag, and before I can get it out, they done flew over me. I said, oh, man, we're quick enough. time I got my camera, went to put it back in my camera case, I heard them begin to look back. Here they come back over the lake. They went back across and turned about halfway around, and then here they come back, and they landed right out about from here to that wall, about 20 yards from us, and just stopped right there. 18 Canadian hoppers. These 18 geese right here.
And James Madden's geese probably.
That's who it was.
They go all the ponds around here.
I've come to find that out. Well, that freaks us out, though, because we've never experienced anything like that. But I took about 175 pictures of them right there falling up in front of the boat. Finally got kind of bored from doing it. I thought, well, I need to go back to fishing, see if I can beat this one that my brother-in-law done putting the boat on me. And I said, it's going to be hard to top that one today. And I ain't going to never hear the end of it. You know, he beat me one time. So anyway. Well, I went back to fishing, and them geese just went to following up right behind the boat. Of course, I looked back there and looked. And about the time I threw out in the middle of the lake, it was wide open out there, nothing, not a tree stick or nothing. I threw my bait out there, and I yanked it about twice, and don't get a hit, and I start reeling it under the water. I get about 10 feet on it, and all of a sudden, whoo, man, I feel it. I said, that's a monster, man. I said, get ready. And I wheel that thing, get it all the way to the boat, and I come out of there, and there's a duck on the end of it. So, anyway, after we finally detached the duck from my bait and safely released it, I thought, this must be time to go to the house, because I think Sasquatch is fishing to make his appearance very much longer. True story. Got one more story for you. You can believe this or not, it's like one of them Ripley deals. This man right here, y'all see this guy right here, his name is Keith Burns. He was on Caddo Lake on March the 20th, 2010, free fishing for a charity tournament. And he had this guy with him that's never been bass fishing in his life up there. And he was going along there, and he found this little spot that it looked good. He said, man, let's go over there to the trees. Had three cypress trees together. He said, there'll be a fish laying over there. He said, if I could just make that shot right in between them trees, he said, I hope he won't lay in there. So he threw that bait up there, and lo and behold, it hung on the cypress knee right beside it. He said, my throwing wouldn't work too. And he said, well, he tried to work it off the stump, and he finally got it to fall down in between the trees. And he looked up, and there was boats everywhere in every position he looked at. He said, let's get out of here. He said, there's too many people fishing in here. And he went to reel his line in, get his flag out, and about that time, he said, something's on the end. That's what it was right there.
Wow.
At 11:30 a.m., this man caught this 16.17-pound bass. Would have been the Louisiana state record bass if he'd waded in on the Louisiana side. He had docked the boat. He caught it on the Louisiana side, but he docked it on the Texas side. So he wasn't able to claim. I don't know if the authorities ever let it go in the record books or not. It was still up for, you know, to be decided on. But anyway, they got the replica program. I don't know if y'all know about it, but anything over 10 pounds, they'll mount it for you free if you just, you know, call them. They'll come out there and weigh them, take measurements of the fish and everything, and they'll tag it, then release it back into the lake. You know, a big mature bass like this can have anywhere from 65,000 eggs or up. And that's a lot of, you know, fry to reproduce and, you know, keep a lot of fish in the lake going. So they done all the weighing and tagging and everything. They called them up and said, we got your fish back, you know, do you want to release it yourself? He said, yeah, I'll meet you at the boat dock. So he went and took the fish and took it out there and turned it loose on the very tree that he caught it. Okay, this is where the story gets good now. This, you can believe this or not, this is a true story. This guy right here, his name is Sean Swank. And 1 year, almost exactly to the date later, on March 18, 2011, he hangs into this 16.07 bass. Well, he knew it was a good one, but he didn't know it was that good. But he called the officials in because he wanted to get in on that lumper program. So they took the fish in, they called him and told him, he said, I don't know if you knew this or not, this was the one that was the state record last year that was caught by Mr. Burns. And the fish had actually lost a few ounces in the size, but it was 2 inches longer. And so come to find out, both guys knew each other, and that was what was ironic about it. And they got to talking to each other about the fish, and this guy here asked Kevin, he said, well, what about did you catch this fish at, release this fish at? And they got their heads together, and he actually caught it 300 yards from where the other boy had turned the thing loose. I thought that was an incredible story, just, you know, to keep catching that same bait. He's had a humongous fish. That's one of the things I live for, is hanging into stuff like this. I caught a couple of decent ones, but nothing like this. I got a 9.57, 8.5, and several sixes and sevens. That's what the dream is like that. That's like that big mighty buck, you know, that's got the rash on it like that for days. That concludes my fishing stories. I got a bunch more of it.
I got a question though. When did the McEachern's move to Minden, Louisiana?
Well, my father said they moved in when he was 8 years old, and that would be 1934. And I'm not sure if that's 100% correct, but the house that I'm living in, he told me that he lived there in an old bungalow style house when he
was on the Dorchy Road.
Dorchy Road, there. On the old family home.
Well, what did most of them do? Were they bricklayers?
All of this family was bricklayers. I was the only oddball out. I ended up going into cooking business or something. My brother went to work with my uncle Prentice and several of them. He said, boy, you don't want to get in there bricklayer. That's too much work in that. I see him come in and look like somebody done dumped him in a cement mixture. I thought, yeah, that's a pretty nasty job. And I said, I don't think I want to get into that. I said, maybe I can do something where I can use my brain a little bit, what little bit I got.
How many was it? How many kids was it?
It was 11 of them in my grandmother's family.
I thought it was 12.
It's 12. 12.
12. 12. I miscounted.
12.
12. 12.
I'm sorry.
Don't leave me out.
I forgot about the baby born on my grandfather's birthday.
Eight boys and four girls.
I always associated
my daddy going to the ice house on Pine Street, and it was
McEachern's
everywhere.
John Henry worked there and got my daddy a job there.
To me, I've always associated McEachern's selling the ice, because they all looked just like
that's
him.
That's how my father met my mother. He was selling ice to the family where my aunt Opal and Bill Chandler lived, and my mother was, you know, staying with them, and that's where he met them.
And we got into a debate over how the ice was frozen, if it was frozen there or did it come in, and I think
it's frozen there.
Yes,
frozen
that's there. What this fellow over here said, one of my crowd cousins, straight.
I wasn't sure how they done it, but they said they used to pack it in sawdust to keep it from melting. I thought that was interesting there.
That's when he delivered the truck.
But that's another story.
Any other question I'd lie about? Or?
It'll be 80 in September, as a matter of fact.
80?
80, yeah. It'll be 80 in
September. Let me just recognize all the McEachern's and McEachern's in here. Y'all stand up and just see how most of you, that's what you are in here. This ain't a drop in the bucket. I'm going to have to get on some of them. They say they don't melt. They know they ain't made out of sugar.
I don't have a picture of the ice house.
I wish I did. John Hickey has one, though. I do have one in his book, but I was afraid to use it without his permission.
Well, that's just, to me, I was fascinated. Dad would go up there, they would saw. They would get these big hooks and pull that, and then they would saw off a little, probably 25 pounds, put in his ice chest for fishing. And I was this little girl.
I remember there. I'm just a little too. It was there. They had me out on the city road also. That's been many days that's gone by since that time. Any other questions? I want to leave end this program tonight with a poem. This takes this to the memory of my father, Wesley Carson McEachern. Daddy came from the old school. He was a farmer, and he loved to get out there on that little Cub tractor. He could tear up that old thread of clay out there. I don't know how in the world he ever was able to raise anything, but he raised peas and potatoes and stuff and fed our six children that him and his mama raised on that little garden. And I thought this would be a good commemorative for me. This poem that I wrote for him a few years after he passed, it's called Meet Me in the Garden. I can see him in the garden plowing up that hardened clay on that old red faded tractor just plowing away. How he got a single thing to grow in that old dirt. made me come to realize just how hard my daddy worked. Rising early in the morning, he would grab his coffee cup, then he'd head out for the garden as the sun was coming up. Pulling grass and chopping weeds with his old trusty hoe, before you could turn around, he'd be on another road. Well, pretty soon, I would hear my daddy calling me, saying, "Meet me in the garden, son, it's time to pick the peas." I'd grab that old green bucket and start wading through those vines. Those purple hulls sure carried us straight through the wintertime. But the years have come and quickly gone since my daddy passed away. But I can see him still in that garden here today. And surely as the morning sun, I hear him calling me, saying, "Meet me in the garden, son, it's time to pick the peas." Good night, everybody. God bless you.